Central Church. This week is Food Pantry Week. Truck unload and bagging will be Tuesday at 9 a.m. Food distribution will be Wednesday at 6 p.m. There will be a brief report from the Unified Worship Committee regarding their work on our single service format immediately following the morning worship service today. All are welcome to attend. Next Sunday, immediately following the morning worship service, will be our annual charge conference. Again, all are welcome to stay and attend. Come and go prayer time will be every Tuesday from 5:30 to 6:30. Please remember that the offering plates are available for you at each doorway. I'll turn it over to Laura now for an announcement on Trunk or Treat.
As you know, Wednesday, October the 28th is Trunk or Treat. I sent out an email about bagging your candy. If it's already individually bagged, it does not have to be put in the bag. I know, you know, that's at an expense. All I ask is that right now, what's going on, let's not do one-way goodies or pour stuff in a bag. Just try to do it individually wrapped. I also ask, if you run out, please don't pull up the parking lot this year. It is a drive-through and not a walk-through. Find me. We may have some fall festival stuff left over. We'll try to redo you best we can. We're excited about it, and hope you show up Wednesday, October 28th and 6th.
All right. You would stand and we sing together.
So Kevin asked me to read today's scripture, and I thought it was really cool because God really works in mysterious ways, because this was the exact verse that was highlighted and bookmarked in my Bible. So today's scripture comes from Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. Beloved, would you please join me in a word of prayer? Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the opportunity to come together and worship your precious and holy name today. Lord, we ask that you help us seek the good in all things. Most of the time we lose sight of all the positives and focus on the negatives. We come to you today with an open heart and an open mind. Lord, help us to be more like you, patient, loving, kind, and diligent. God, you work for the good because you see other people's purpose and potential. Father God, we pray that we can do the same, maybe today, tomorrow, or someday. I pray that when everybody in the sanctuary leaves today, Father, that they will be on a mission to please you this week. We thank you for your many blessings. We love you and we thank you. Amen.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come gathered together to lift up your name, call on our Savior, call on your praise. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit.
church.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good to see all of you. Thanks be to you for coming and to God for our ability to worship Him. The scripture this morning is Psalm 84. I'll be reading all of the 12 verses. Hear now the reading of the Holy Word. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, indeed it faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself where she may lay her young. At your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise. Happy are those whose strength is in you, whose heart are the highways of Zion. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The early rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. The God of gods will be seen in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold our shield, O God. Look on the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. He bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you. This is God's word for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In good time and in bad, in those times in which we are sad and sorrowful, and yet we are able to have faith and be joyful and know and look for the good, the Psalms always speak to us. We turn to them over and over again for comfort and hope and faith. The Psalms are full of human emotions. We're sometimes up and sometimes down as we read the Psalms. They're filled with evil, all kinds of human evil, and the experiences of wrestling and struggling with the fate of life. Sometimes we read the Psalms and we find all kinds of experiences there that we experience, and we turn to them to find a way to God. This psalm is a very powerful psalm, and I've come to love and study this psalm and rejoice in it over and over again. It's Psalm 84. Imagine being on a journey, a caravan, moving through countryside after countryside, and as it begins, yearning to get to the temple of the Lord, yearning to be in the house of God, dreaming and hoping for the day when they might be able to sit at the altars of God and see what happens there, saying, even the sparrow finds a place at your altar. I'm not there yet, but I'm yearning and yawning and desiring to be there. This psalm has a very powerful message. For in it, in verse 7, I walk, I journey through the valley of Baca. That word means tears. Think of the valley of tears. And that person is there as they write this psalm. The valley of tears. And then They begin to write about the spring rains and how that dry, desolate desert is turned into a beautiful flower garden with pools of water gathered here and there. They have made this journey many times in their lives. And they have seen it in the dry desert, and they have seen it with the pools of water, an array of flowers. The seeds were there waiting for the rains. From a desert transformed into a beautiful garden. That is really the message and the experience of this psalmist as he writes. How do we transform those bad experiences into good experiences? We have bad experiences. All of us do. One of you said to me not long ago, I'm tired of wearing the mask. I'm tired of not being able to shake hands with people and embrace people. But the thing I miss most about what's happening in church today is that we're not able to eat together. Yeah, oh, I heard that. Yes. We're not able to eat together. Well, I enjoy a little food every once in a while, and so do you. But we will keep on. We will keep on in the desert, wearing the mask. We will keep on the social distancing. We will keep on saying, I wish I could give you an embrace. And the day will come when our desert will become a spring, and flowers will grow, and we'll be able to share a meal. How do we transform the bad into good? Well, there are people who somehow feel that good will outweigh the bad if we do it right. I remember sitting in a Sunday school class, and one of the persons turned to me and said, Preacher, don't you believe that our good will outweigh our bad and God will let us in? And I said, would you repeat that? I want to make sure I hear it. And the person said it again, and I said, the answer is no. It's not a matter of compensation. It's not a matter of compensation, which reminds me of a story of a very wealthy woman who, when she died, she went to heaven and found that she was given a bicycle to get around the streets of gold. She was doing pretty good until she saw the maid who had worked for her for years riding in a limousine. And she went to St. Peter to find out what was going on. And he said, well, it's a matter of compensation. You've had the glories of life while you were on earth, and she did not have them, and now it's reversed. It's compensation. And she went away very sadly. A few days later, she was riding her bike, and people were hearing her singing and joyfully making noises, and someone stopped and said, what's going on? And she said, well, I was doing pretty good, and I was sad. But then I saw my pastor on roller skates. Now that's compensation. That's not it. That's not the way we transform bad into good. We've seen heartbreak. We've experienced those bad times in our lives. We know what it is to be down and out and unable to do anything at all. I remember a young couple in the church I served as pastor. They were involved. They were doing well. She was expecting children. I got a call early one morning and said, we're at the hospital. Could you come? And I went to the hospital, and they lost the children, the twins. And I visited with them, I shared with them, I listened to them, I heard their grief over and over and over again. Why? And finally the day came when they began to see the light at the end of the tunnel. And they were able to move on and learn that even that bad experience might be able to turn into good. It happened on Palm Sunday in 1994. Goshen United Methodist Church. The church was full of people and youth and children, and things were in process of demonstrating that great passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. And they were struck by a tornado. People were killed, including the older daughter of the pastor, Hannah Clem. Kelly Clem had been on the staff as one of the pastors at Anniston First Church where I served. Dale served as a minister to the student body at Jacksonville State University. I had served as their district superintendent as well. But we were away. We were already in Birmingham. And I remember getting calls and asked if I could pick up Dale from the airport, because he had been away on a meeting of student pastors. And I did. And 2 days afterwards, Sally and I had agreed when she got in from school that we would drive to Goshen and see if we might be able to see Kelly and Dale. When we arrived, I saw the rubble of the church. I looked at that. I preached there many times, but I saw the rubble. I saw everything destructed. And then I saw a man. I walked over to him, and he looked at me and said, "Oh, yes, you're the..." I said, "No, I'm not the DS now. I have been." And he began to pour out his heart. He said, "We're done. We can't go forward. Too many people have lost their lives. Many are injured. This church is dead." And I listened to his grief as he poured out his heart over and over again. And then I said to him, "I'm praying for you and for this church. And what I know is that God will bless you. And you will find a way. You will find a way." And as if it were just a thought that God gave me, "Think," I said, "of the death of Jesus and the cross and all that took place in the hearts and lives of the fear and the anger that must have been in the hearts and lives of those who had been following him. And then all of that on Friday and Sunday, he was alive again." And I said to him, "Just think about that for a while." I was there not long ago for a funeral service. The memorial is there. They don't forget. But they have a beautiful, beautiful facility, and the church is doing well. Turning bad into good. How do we do it? Well, we know it's not compensation. We know that's for sure. It is moving forward and bringing our best to what God wants to do. Mike was a young man in the church. He had been injured when he was just a child. He was no longer able to walk. He was in the bed 24/7. He was very bright. He read a lot. He had a great smile. He had a radio, police radio. If you wanted to know anything going on in town, he knew it, and you could just ask him. Sometimes when I would go see him, he would tell me more than I wanted to know. We were not at the point where we had the ability to send messages online. But we did what many churches did, and that was we taped the sermons, the service, and people would come and copy those things and carry them to people who were homebound. And Mike got a copy every week. And sometimes he'd want to talk about what was going on, something he had read, something that was going on in town with the police radio. And sometimes he'd want to talk about the sermons. And sometimes he'd raise questions I did not expect. But he had brought his best. He was doing the very best he could under bad circumstances. Bringing our best. Transforming bad into good. That's our business and God's business. And God is leading us to do that business all the time. It's not just thinking positively. It's bringing what we can. You have seen people in similar circumstances. One conquers and one collapses. I've seen churches in similar circumstances. People give up and people refuse to give up. God is calling us every day to turn the bad experiences that may come our way into good. Sometimes we can't do it all. We shouldn't even try to do it all. But God calls us to do our best. I know. We've been through a lot. You've been through a lot. Not just the pandemic, but all of the experiences that have taken place and resulting even in my being here. I was shocked as much as you were. And I don't know it all. I don't need to know. What I need to know is that we can bring our best. And God will do more than we ever think in ministry in this church. There's a proverb which I like. As we think in our hearts, so are we. Not just positive thinking, but bringing our best to place at the altar of God. See this camel caravan moving through the desert, yearning and longing and desiring to be in the temple of God. They've been there on special occasions, no doubt. They know what the altars look like. But they're not there. And they come to the valley of Baca, the valley of tears. They could lay down and weep and cry and mourn. But they begin to see that dry desert, those little seeds waiting for the rains. And they've seen those little seeds sprout up with moisture, flowers everywhere, pools of fresh water, because God has given the rain. Dear friends, I pray for the rain, and I want us to bring our best. Listen to this psalm. Blessed are those who trust in you, O God. Blessed are those who trust in you. 2-3 years ago, I went to visit a person I had not met in a hospital. I knew the family, but I had not met this person. I'd gotten the room number, I walked to the floor, I got off, I walked to the desk, the door was closed, and I asked if so-and-so was in the room, and the nurse I asked said, yes, I've just been in there, he's awake. So I tapped on the door. I went inside, I had a wonderful visit, we prayed together. He was doing well, physically doing very well. When I walked out, that nurse who told me yes said, you must be a preacher. I didn't have on a collar, I didn't have on a cross, there was nothing visibly that they could see to indicate that. You must be a preacher. And I said, yes, I am. She said, wait a minute. She wrote down Zephaniah. It's in the Bible. It's in the Old Testament. Zephaniah 3:17. When I got in the car, I had a New Testament with Psalms, so Zephaniah was not included. But I got home that day, and I looked it up. Here is the message that she gave to me from the Lord. Listen. The Lord is in your midst. He will rejoice over you with glad message. He will renew you with love. He will renew you in love. May it be so, Lord, with us as we bring our best in transforming bad into good. Let us pray. Father, for these times together, for these holy moments, to hear what you have to say to all of us, not what I say, but what you say, we give thanks. And we ask for your guidance as we take day by day, step by step, into the future to which you lead us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, great are you, your praise.
just want to remind you briefly before you receive the benediction that we're going to have a short presentation from the Unified Worship Team, Committee, whatever you want to call it, right after the service. So if you want to stick around for that, you can do so. We won't take long, I promise. So with that, I would you receive the benediction. May we go from this place to give thanks to the God that brings us out of the valley of tears and turns our bad into good. And the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.